Good evening, everyone. It's been more than a month since we were here. And Rosh Hashanah has passed, Yom Kippur, Sukkot, Shmini Atzeret, Simchat Torah. It worked out that every one of the holidays fell mamash on our schedule. A new year is starting now. It's very difficult to start the year, for me, personally. You know, once you get to a different schedule with the family, with the learning, with the books, you're already in heaven. Then you have to drive yourself all the way to here, 2 hours to get here or more, and into the new atmosphere again. For me, I feel like mamash, it's like a building on my shoulders. But Bezrat Hashem, I pray to Hashem that will give me the energy to get on a roll. Once you're on a roll, that's it. You have the siyata dishmaya, but to start a new cycle is very, very difficult. But it works out beautiful when we're starting another circle of the year with the Torah. We started now, after, you know, we're going to start this Shabbat, Parashat Bereshit, the beginning of the Torah. And there are many interesting things are coming. We're expecting now the election. We don't know what's going to happen. It's going to affect, obviously, the way the world will be in the next few years. We will know in 2 weeks what Hashem plans is for us. We don't know yet. There are a few possibilities. One, that Clinton will be the president. And that already means that we're going back into a cold war with Russia, because she and Putin are big enemies. They hate each other very much. And you know, in life, it's all about personal relationship. All the relationship between countries, it's all depend on the relationship between the two leaders. If they get along together, they have good chemistry, they understand each other, they speak in the same language, everything works out. If not, nothing works out. The rest is all a cover-up. So there's no chance here, because with their approach and Russia's approach, it's too opposite. Who knows what can happen? It can lead to a world war and a nuclear war. That's one thing, especially what happens in Syria. She's going to fill up New York with tens of thousands of Arabs. It's enough that 1% of them will be terrorists. I don't have to tell you how horrible life is going to be here in the next year or two. So that's one option. With her, with the liberalism, with the Democrats in control, expanding, you know, the debt of this country until we're going to go bankrupt, and who knows what's going to happen with China. It doesn't look good. With her, I expect a disaster in the next 4 or 8 years. With him, it's not going to be a lot better. Why? It's one thing that your opinions are correct. The question is who you are as a human being. It's a very big problem. If a person is not 100% normal, and the ego, it's like a spiritual cancer that eats him from inside and destroys him, what good is that your opinions are correct? You don't know to behave like a human being. You have to be the president of the country, of the world. The way you talk, the way you behave, the way you express yourself. It's very hard to know what's worse. Really, it's hard to know. One thing I know, at least with him, is going to be much better for Israel. Much better. Better than it ever been. I have no doubt about this. And also, it's going to be pretty good for the Jews in general. Not because his daughter converted to Judaism and he has a lot of Jewish friends. That's besides the point. It can also help. Because of the way his ideology is. Because of the way he thinks about Islam, about terrorism, about Arabs in general, about what's happening in the world. When it comes to terrorism, he's not an idiot. He's thinking straight. And this is now the most urgent subject in the globe. Nothing is more urgent than this. Because a person has to be a fool not to see that with a weak president like Obama was, very, very weak character, another 4 years like this, the United States will be taken by ISIS, just like Europe. That's their dream. They're not giving up their dream. and she's going to help bringing them in just like that. Please, welcome, you know. And many of them, even if not everyone is an active terrorist, you don't always need to be an active terrorist. It's enough that your ideology is an ideology of this murderer terrorist. That's already a problem. They're helping in all kinds of ways. They hide them, they give money, they drive, they do other things. It's a problem. Look what happened in Europe, look what happened in France, in Belgium, in Holland, Germany. Before they arrive to Germany, they already announce that as soon as they get there, they will destroy Germany. They're not even hiding it. It's crazy. If a person comes to a country and he want them to open the gates for him, that he can first walk in, then he will do his terrorist act. With them, they're so honest that they tell you in their speeches, don't forget when you arrive to Germany, don't be puzzled by their hospitality. Remember our mission. We gotta take them over and destroy them and kill them all. I speak like this in YouTube. And the Germans are still idiots. They bring them in. Why? Human rights. Mercy. Mercy? They'll slaughter you. Mercy. In America, at least with him, it won't happen. With her? Ooh, what's going to happen? One way or the other, with him, it can be also a world war. Because there's one thing you have to understand. The Arabs are different than the rest of the nations. If you have a problem with another nation, England, Argentina, France, any civilized nation, you have a war, it can be a war, and it's over eventually, you reach agreements, and it's over. If you go after the Arabs, and you make their life tough, and you begin to check them out, and you check their emails, and you listen to their phone calls, and they will feel the pressure, they are not the Jews who stood online and on the line to the gas chambers to be burned. It's a different story with the Arabs. As soon as you pressure them, they retaliate 100 times worse. So it's a no-win situation. To be quiet, they're taking us over. It's a matter of 10, 20 years, the country is finished. We'll all be dead, all over the world. You retaliate to them, there will be massive riots, explosions, gunshots, every hour. Buses can explode, trains, one way or the other. Why we are in this situation? Hashem put us here, that's it. The day Ishmael was born, that was already the plan of Hashem. If the world would lose his morality, I will have the Arabs to take care of them. This wild beast, Ishmael, that the Torah says, Ishmael pere adam yado bakol viyat kolbo. He is going to teach the world a lesson. That's it. We, as Jews that received the Torah and taught the world manners, we taught the world ethics, we taught the world about God, we taught the world about heaven and hell, about life after death, we taught the world about the body and soul, we thought everything the world knows about religion, they learn from the Jews. Even Muhammad named us the nation of the book. It's nothing to hide here. No one denies it. Even Obama in his speech in the funeral of Shimon Peres in Jerusalem, in part of his speech he said, we, the Christian Jewish culture, meaning he puts them together as one culture. There's obviously a huge difference between us and the Christians. But the foundation is very, very similar. They believe in God. They believe in reward and punishment. They have a lot of similar things that they learned from the Torah. They call the Torah the Old Testament. Later, they added their nonsense and ruined everything. If they wouldn't add their nonsense, they would be more or less similar to Judaism. They add their nonsense and they blew up everything. But in general, everybody understands. Whatever they have, they learn from us. They learn from us. It's different like the Hindus. That's a different culture completely. Nothing to do with us. Or the Buddhists. Even though there's some similarity about the enlightenment and seeing the light and spirituality, fine. And that some of the things that they do and say, but in general, they're very far from us. But Islam And Christianity is a very cheap imitation of Judaism. You have to be a fool not to see it. Very, very. The Muslims, they pray 5 times a day. Why? Because the Jews pray 3 times a day, and 1 time a year they pray 5 times, which is Yom Kippur. So the Muslims say, we will be like the holiest day of the Jews every day, 5 times a day. Why? We will be better than them. The Jews built Beit HaMikdash in the Moriah mountain. The Arabs came all the way to build their mosque right where Beit HaMikdash was. Everything that they do is imitation of what the Jews were doing or still doing. Everything. The concept of Muhammad being a prophet. Where do they even know about prophet, about prophecy? All comes from the Jewish prophets. You don't believe me? Go to the Hamas website. See over there. How they speak about the Jewish prophets. Peace be on them. Peace be on them. Peace be on them. They're not denying their holiness. They just add their nonsense later on and ruin everything. Man-made additions to the Torah, which, lucky us, contradict completely the principles of Hashem. At least if they would do a good job, it would be very difficult to catch the cheap imitation. You see, when you make an imitation, if the imitation is very good, it's very difficult for ordinary people to tell the difference. It's very easy to fool them. But if the imitation is not good, all you have to do is a little bit clever right away to see. I'll give you an example. The Muslims, because they came to dead end, they didn't have the oral Torah. They didn't have all the knowledge. They didn't know what to do. They had a dilemma. They asked them, if God knows the future, how exactly we choose to do good or bad? It's a contradiction, no? If God knows already what's going to happen, that means we don't choose. We're robots here. So they said, what did they say? They said, it's all min Allah. Everything is from God. Whatever happened, it's already predetermined. It was decided. But in that case, if that's the case, why you execute people? Why you cut people's hands when they steal? If it's all min Allah, they're all robots. They don't deserve a punishment. They live the contradiction every second of their life. On one hand, they say everything is from God. We don't really choose, technically. If it's all from God, that means he does everything. On the other hand, they punish people for making all kinds of crimes. Why? If a person is a robot, he doesn't deserve to be punished. That's already a punishment for him that he's a robot. Now you're giving him punishments for his actions? The Greeks, they had the same dilemma. So they came to the conclusion, according to their foolish understanding, that God doesn't know the future. It cannot be. He only knows the past and the present, but he doesn't know the future. That will explain now how he's still able to choose. And the Jews, they always had the truth. God knows the future, and we 100% choosing. There's no contradiction. In the mind of a human being that is thinking, it all relates to time. We think with time, we walk with time, we go to sleep with time, we wake up with time, we eat with time, we speak with time, we think with time. There's not one transaction in our life without time. Everything relates to time. Everything that you think about, time is a part of the formula. There's not one step in your life that is not related to time. Because of that, the people cannot think out of the box. Everything they think is with time. And time exists only where material exists, meaning in this physical world. But when you go out of the physical world, time doesn't have the same essence. It doesn't work like here. Therefore, it's a whole different strategy. Everything works different. God is not material. He does not have an image or a size or a color. He doesn't have a beginning and an end, because in spirituality, those terms are not valid. You don't have beginning and end. You only have beginning and end in a physical world. In a spiritual world, those terms do not exist. But the people, since their brain and their knowledge is very limited, they have very serious difficulty to understand how it works. That's why many, many people already came to the wrong conclusion that God already did this. That's it. It's not me. He decided that. That's what he wanted. That's what had to be. It's all from heaven. It's all nonsense. It says clearly in the Torah, and you should choose the good. You should choose the life. I'm warning you, I will give you a reward if you do the right thing, I'll give you punishment. That means we choose 100%. He sent us prophets to warn us. If we were robots, why wasting time sending someone to give a false speech? Why teaching Torah? Why giving Torah? The Torah, it's all warnings. Why are you giving warnings to robots? They cannot choose to be good or bad. Why are you wasting your time? Why bringing us out of Egypt and give us the Torah in such a bombastic event? What for? It's all baloney. If we are robots, it's like toys. You're moving us with remote control. Why are you telling me you should not kill? Keep Shabbat, eat kosher. I'm a piece of plastic. What am I? Obviously, everybody reads in the Torah. You see that it's not like that. It's all about reward and punishment. Everything. The whole concept, one of the 13 principles of Judaism. God rewards the righteous and punishes the wicked. But not instantly. That's what confused a lot of people. Where? Where is the justice? Where was God in the Holocaust? Where was God here? Where was God there? All these questions. Why? People expect immediate retaliation. Immediate. Hashem replies immediately. It doesn't work that way. If the retaliation of Hashem would be instant, no one would have a choice. Everyone would be righteous. Now one person will ever say one word of Lashon Hara. Not one person will ever eat something not kosher. Now one person will ever dare to break Shabbat. Why? Who wants to get a punch a second after he made a crime? Or to get killed, or to explode, or to lose a part of his body, or who knows what? Who wants that? As soon as one or two people would do it, and they get punished right on the spot, nobody else would dare to move after that. Why am I moving? I don't want to end like this guy. It's not because people want to be righteous. They just feel the gun to their head. That's no test here. The only way to maintain the test is to show the people some kind of an illusion. You got away with your crimes. Here, you murdered 10 years ago, and you became the president of a big company. You live well, everything is beautiful, you have wife, children, nice car, nice house, great salary. So, you're a murderer, and nobody knows. Here, you see, where is the justice? Justice will come. There's no problem. There's lots of patience. 10, 20, 70, 100 years, it's not even a blink of the eye compared to eternity. And by God, it's all eternal. And when we die, the soul is also eternal. So what's the rush? He has to respond 10 years later? He has to respond 2 years later? No, he can respond 7 years later. He can respond even 200 years later when the soul will be in a new body, Bichlal. It's the same soul. So the people, since obviously they don't have the knowledge, lots of ignorance, most people are misinformed in the basics even. It brings their life to a bunch, everything is a bunch of mistakes. One follow the other. Everything is mistakes. The way they walk, the way they talk, the way they speak, the way they walk on the street, the way they work in a business, the way they speak to people, the way they raise children, the way they eat. Everything is mistakes. If you analyze the average Jew or non-Jew, almost every minute of his life, there is a crime. Every minute, a serious one, which has a serious payment later on. Every second. A lie, another lie, fake, non-modest clothes, eating not things that is not allowed, looking at things that is not allowed, thinking horrible things, not appreciating what he has, all kinds of cheating people and lying to here and pretending to her, to there. Non-stop, not having mercy on people, not helping people when he can, not respecting his parents, not being a good parent, being a good spouse. I can find you millions of problems that we have in an average week. And most of the people don't even care and don't even feel that anything is wrong with their life. They live in such an illusion world, and they one day will have such an unbelievable shock when they will find out that now the payments begins. You know what a disaster it's going to be? Imagine a person living in illusion, sitting in his yacht, smoking cigar, drinking a great whiskey, a servant serving him great food. You know, he's living the life, like they say in America. And then he die, and now he gets a report of how many crimes he made, and what's the price and the payment for each one of them. punishment number one, number two, number three, number five, number 50, number 5,000, number million, number 5 million, number 20 million. Imagine the feeling. Before we get to that situation, obviously we have to make an adjustment. We're starting a new cycle of the Torah now. Maybe this last Rosh Hashanah and Kippur was the last one. I know we've been saying it for a few years already, but we're not that far from the truth. The world is boiling. Earthquake in Italy, another one here, another one. Everything can change in a second. No matter what happened in the world, naturally, natural disasters, it's still peanuts compared to the main problem of the world. What is it? Islam. The biggest danger in the world right now, before cancer, before wars between countries, before financial crisis, before many of the disasters that can happen in the world. The main problem in the world right now, that the world, if the world is a body, the body has cancer. What is the cancer? Islam. It spreads all over the world. It threatens 6 billion people. There's 1.5 billion Arabs, Muslims, all kinds of other Muslims, that they are direct danger to the 6 billion people. As soon as they will have the power, make no mistake, they will not leave one Jew alive, not even one. Not rabbis, not atheists, not liberals, not lefties, even Jews that fought for them, they'll slaughter them with no mercy. That's the agenda. They're not hiding it. I'm not saying anything that is new. All you have to do is to listen to the Friday speeches. They tell you clearly in them, one day, we will not leave one Jew behind the tree. We will not rest until we slaughter all of them. They say it, they announce it, they mean it. It's not just speeches. That's their dream. Same thing Christians. It's very strange. Why it's strange? Muhammad, when he pretended to be a prophet, even though he never gave a prophecy, he never put down the Torah, and he never put down the New Testament. It's very interesting. He speaks about the Torah that God gave to the Jews, and he brought them to the Promised Land. According to him, Israel belongs to the Jews. There's a lot of interesting things written in the Quran about God and the nation of Israel. Some of his wives were Jewish, that he kidnapped and forced them to be his wives. They didn't have that much of a choice. He had one good Jewish friend that he was putting his weapon by him. He trusted him. Many of the things he wrote in the Quran comes from the Torah, about interest, about the pig, the chanzir, which is chazir. Misspelling. They have a lot of errors. Instead of chazir, they wrote chanzir in Arabic, which is very similar. Half of their language comes from Hebrew, if you know a little bit dialect. You know, and in obviously never had intention to put down the Torah because he admitted that it's the word of God. He called his people Ibrahim, Yusuf, Yaqub, Dawood, all these names. Dawood is David. Of course, you know, the pronunciation is not correct, but it comes from the Torah. The interesting part is that he also speaks highly of JC and the New Testament. Besides all the Jewish prophets, he gives credit to Christianity as well. He just claimed that now he's the third one in a row. In that case, please explain to me why the Muslims hate the Christians so much. Why they burn churches. They hate the Jews. This is a divine decree. Ishmael, already, Pere Adam, you have Yitzchak, you have Ishmael. From day one, they were enemies. It's written in the Torah. With Islam, without Islam, there will always be the case. But please explain to me why they burn churches. What do they want from Christians? The answer, they know that in the Torah it's written that God hates idol worshippers. Abraham is symbolized that he was the first one who spread monotheism, the belief in one God. They understand the mistake of their prophet. Why are you giving them credit? The idol worshippers should have killed them all. You didn't do it, we'll do it. Hey, you think they care what he said? Their understanding today, Christianity is idol worshipping. They made another son of God besides God. They gave all these statues in the places. We will not rest until we kill all Christians. So they want to kill all Jews. They want to kill all Christians. What about hundreds of millions of Buddhists? Of course. They're all idol worshippers. Nothing better than Christians. They're much even worse. They have much more gods. Christians have 1.5 gods. They have hundreds of gods. Different ones. All kinds of things. They worship Buddha. They worship this statue, this. And Hinduism, well, there's nothing to talk about. Every other person they made into a god. All kinds of names, the Hindus. And they bow down to the cow and all the rest of the things. Look in India, in Pakistan, in these areas, the Hindus and the Muslims killing each other. All the time, non-stop. So therefore, who do they like in the world? The answer, no one. No one. No one has the right to live. You see, we the Jewish people, we never told the Goyim, we have a mission to kill you. Even if the Goyim are idol worshippers in their countries, we don't have any assignment or a mission or obligation to go and kill them or to destroy their idols in their countries. In our land, the Holy Land, we should not allow it to happen. So we destroy the idols and we give them a chance to be righteous Gentiles or to leave the land. We don't have an obligation to kill them. We don't have an obligation to try or to educate them. We show our light to the world, and whatever they want to do, it's up to them. But in my living room, you're not going to worship your idols. That's it. That's the only thing. You want to do it in China? Go do it there. You want to do it in India? Go do it over there. It's not my problem. Uvi'arta harav mikirbecha, it says in the Torah. Clean the bed from among yourself. Not all over the world. We don't have an obligation to run and correct the whole world. So therefore, we're not a threat to anyone. We should live in our tiny country, which is smaller than New Jersey, and let the world do whatever they want in their country. 99.999% of the world belongs to Gentiles. A drop, a tiny little dot in a map belongs to the Jews. And the whole world wants to steal it from the Jews. Look at the hypocrisy over here. But this tiny place, we want to live according to the rules of the Torah. The rest of the world, it's up to you. You do whatever you want. It's not a problem. We don't have any agenda to invade your countries, to come to fight you. We don't have any obligation to force our religion on you the other way around. If you come and beg us to become Jewish, our mission is to tell you, no, you don't want. You shouldn't. Just stay a righteous Gentile. We're not missionaries. We're not interested to make the religion bigger. We're not interested to get more and more voters. We're not interested. If it was up to us, no one should come. No one. Let them stay in their country. We have our own tiny nation. That's enough. We don't have an obligation. We don't have Jewish missionaries going every country like the Christians trying to force people to turn into the religion. We don't have that. It's against our religion. Our religion is the other way around. You want to join us, you have to sweat very much to prove that you're worthy of it. We're not interested in you. You want? If you be good, then of course we don't have the right to tell you not to come to the nation of God because God himself said that it's permitted. We cannot go against his will. But there's no obligation to run and hunt people like the Christians do and the Muslims with the power. Christians with their mouth and their lies, and the Muslim with their swords and bombs. We don't have it. By the way, in Judaism, you also have missionary groups. There are some missionary groups in Judaism. They have a cult, and they want everyone to be like them. Yes. The mutual thing is that they keep Shabbat, they eat kosher, they celebrate the holidays, they put tefillin. There's a lot of similarity. But they have few ideologies that is not coming from Judaism. It's coming from somewhere else. And how do you know in Judaism where you have the truth and not? Remember this rule. Any Judaism that are missionaries, meaning they go and send messengers all over to turn people into their group, are all lies. Remember this. Groups that wants to live by themselves, we want to be like this, but we have no agenda to run and force people to turn into our group. No. We want to do this way. This is our rabbi. We have our own group over here. You do whatever you like. We want to be together. That's it. No problem. It's no problem. It's no contradiction. Once they begin to send messengers everywhere with books and try to turn everyone into the group, then you know it's a lie. That's the rule. Every group that sends people to do everything they can to turn people into the group, something is fishy here. Remember this rule. If you will remember this, you will know who to be careful from. Judaism doesn't need groups, doesn't need cults, doesn't need all of that. We have the 13 principles, we have the Torah, we have the Oral Torah, we have the Shulchan Aruch, that's it. We have Gemara. It's for everyone. For all Jews, Ashkenazi, Sfaradi, Hasidi, Temani, from all directions of the world. We all have the same Torah. All the extras that came in the last 200-300 years, you don't need it. I promise you, you won't add anything to your Avodat Hashem. If any, it only will make damage. And I can tell you from experience of 22 years. It doesn't help anyone. It messed up their mind. It takes them away from the real target. Things that are not important become the most important in their lives. And the most important thing in the Torah become nothing. The things that they focus on. Why? Because once people begin to idolize a human being, a rabbi or anyone, whether he's alive, whether he's dead, or a certain ideology, something modern, then you know the lie penetrates into the truth. Truth with the lie mix, it's 100% lie. There's no such thing half true. There's either 100% true or a lie. There's no such thing 99% true. 99% true, it's a lie. That's what a lot of Jews don't understand. They say, well, at least there's this good, and this is good over there, and this is good over there. Okay, so there's one bad thing. One thing it's a lie, everything is a lie. That's the way it is. That's why I always tell people, run away from this place. What do you need for? What do you need it for? Someone invented it 100 years ago. All of a sudden, something new. 3,100 years, nobody needed it, and now all of a sudden, no one can live without it? Where does it come from? But people obviously think with their heart, not with their brain. And once you think with your heart, you make a lot of mistakes. So, like I said, the new cycle starts. Maybe it was the last Rosh Hashanah, the last Judgment Day. We will know. By the next Rosh Hashanah, we will definitely know. Maybe it was the last chance to do Tshuva Yom Kippur, the last Rosh Hashanah Rabbah, which is the final note is given to Malach HaMavet, the angel of death. Right now we still don't know, but we will know soon. By the way the year will be, then we will know retroactively what was God's decision. In the Torah, Bereshit bara Elokim, Bereshit means in the beginning, Bereshit bara Elokim, in the beginning God created heaven and earth, the sky, the earth. Everything was all messy, completely mixed out. Everything mixed. Meaning there's water all over, and the Spirit of God is above the water, and all is darkness in the beginning. And there's heaven and earth. And then the order started right away. The order started. There are a few things that were created, or at least the plan was, before the world was created. One, the Torah. The Torah is the blueprint of the world, meaning the Torah had to be before the world was created. That's the plan of the world. When you have a building, what do you have? You have the blueprint first. Go to the architect, design the building, he puts everything in the right place. Without it, you cannot build a building. There's no way to build a building without a plan. Or a house, or an apartment, or anything, or even a furniture. Even in furniture, they write the measurements and how it's going to connect, and the angles, and how it's going to be. Over here it's an arch, and here it has to be a sharp turn, and over here it's going to open. It's, all these things, it comes in a plan. They don't design it while they work. The design is first, then comes the creation. So the Torah was given. The Torah, Kisei HaKavod, the chair of Hashem. Don't try to understand it literally, please. because for sure you will be wrong. There's no such thing, a real chair of Hashem that he got it from the carpenter in Chinatown. It doesn't work that way, like some genius people think. When they say the chair of Hashem, it's all divine language, it's analogies, it's parables, it's very deep, it's Kabbalistic, it's mystical, name it the way you want, doesn't matter. But it's not literal. It's not that God has legs and he sits with his arms like this on his beautiful chair, like right here, there's a nice chair over here, look. Beautiful, and he sits and he has a beautiful long white beard and a nice peot and a very big turban. And he sits and he say, my sons, today is the judgment day. This is good for the cartoons. In reality, there's no such thing. Because it's against the law to imagine God in any way. You cannot imagine him in a shape, in an image, in a color, in anything. Some say even in letters you cannot imagine him. But according to Kabbalah, you can imagine the word Yud Kei Vav Kei, the letter Yud, Hei, Vav, and Hei, with the nekudot of the word Ira. Ira means fear. Fear. So Yud has Chirik, one dot underneath. That makes it E. And when you have Shva, it's E. And when, you know, you have Kamatz, is A. So all these, this is how you pronounce the word. The word in English or in Spanish, the letters are actually determine the pronunciation, like A, O, I. That's how you know. But in Hebrew, you have the nekudot, the dots. That's how you know how to pronounce the words. So the word Yud Kei Vav Kei doesn't have nekudot. You don't have nekudot. But according to Kabbalah, if you imagine those four letters of Hashem, Yud, Hei, Vav, and Hei, and under the Yud, one dot, and under the Hei, two dots, which is Shva, under the Vav, Kamatz, like a plus sign by upside down, and the Hei without anything underneath, and you imagine it, it's very good to purify the mind and to have connection with Hashem. But in general, according to the halakha, like I say, there's no need to imagine God in any way. There is a creator of the world, and that's it. And we talk to him, and we pray to him, and we cry to him, and we request from him, and we ask him for forgiveness, and we learn his Torah. That's it. As simple as it is. So, the Kisei HaKavod, which is all the way in the seventh heaven, in a spiritual world. The fathers of the Jewish nations, that was a part of the plan. Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. Without the Judaism, couldn't be. You needed three holy fathers. Very deep. This was already in the plan before the world was created. The whole Torah, the three fathers, Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov. The nation of Israel, the world needed a special nation. Everyone is welcome to join them, but they are the most important in the world. You want to join them? No problem, you can join. Follow the guidelines, the rules, and you're welcome. You don't want to live according to the rules? Stay a Gentile. It's not a crime to stay a Gentile. It's an upgrade to turn into Judaism. You want to be a Gentile, you can be a righteous Gentile and go to heaven according to your level, and it's fine. That's the way I made you, that's the way you die. Bilam, the prophet of the Goyim, when he came to curse the Jewish nation and the assignment of Balak and his nation, they hired him to curse the Jewish nation. It's written in the Torah, Christians and Muslims, they read the same Torah. They believe in the same Torah, but they're not paying attention to what they read. Because if they would pay attention, they will never dare to say one bad word against the Jews. Why? They would read the word of the greatest prophet of the Goyim. The greatest Goy that was a prophet in the Torah is Bilam. Bilam, the leader of the Goyim, of all the Goyim, they all admired him. He was in the generation of Moses. It wasn't a little clown from the market. The head of the goyim. The goyim went, they send him messenger, will give you tons of gold, anything you want. He has divine power to curse the Jewish nation. Who would hire someone, pay him fortune, any amount, you name it. Write down the amount on a check. Just do what we want. And he came, and what did he say? He said, "Tamut nafshi mot yesharim, v'tihi achariti kamohu." One verse, it's enough for every normal Gentile to get the point. And this wasn't said by Moshe, the Jew. It was said by the prophet of the Goyim, which makes it even better for the Goyim. It's one of them. What did Bilam write? Bilam say, "Tamut nafshi mot yesharim. I want to die like this nation." He's coming to curse the Jewish nation and he's blessing them. Part of the blessing was, "I want to die like these Jews. V'tihi achariti kamohu. That my end should be where their end is." Meaning, when the Jews and the Goyim died, they all got to the ground. Whether it's Queens, whether it's Brooklyn, whether it's Tel Aviv, doesn't matter. All over the world, Jews and non-Jews. Over here it's a Jewish section. Over here it's a non-Jewish section. 5 steps away. Ma, the ground is different. It's the same cemetery. Same area, same zip code. Everything the same. So what does it mean? I want to have the end where the Jews ending. Why? They didn't know that Jews and Goyim are all buried in the same field? What does it mean? It means, Tamut nafshi, my soul should die the death of this nation. And I want to end where they will end. Meaning the Jews and the Goyim are not ending in the same place. End of story. Why? They are the children of God and the others are not. That's it. That's reality. I did not write the rules. I will tell you more than that. If it was up to me, I would ask God, just make everyone go to the same place. Let everyone go to the greatest place. My eye is not against anyone else. If you're fine with that, I'm fine with that. We don't have any interest not to let them have good. Why? We're not into revenge. We're not seeking for the others to suffer. That's not our culture. The opposite. One of the most beautiful things about us is to be merciful. What was all my lectures in the month of Elul? Forgive, forgive, forgive others, forgive your enemies, forgive. Why? Forgive them. Hashem will forgive you all measure for measure. But they don't deserve forgiveness. Right! But you don't do it for them. You do it for yourself. It makes you pure. Purify your soul. If you live with anger and hate, it destroyed you. It destroyed your own life. Seeking for revenge comes from not a good place. A perfect human being will never seek for revenge. The opposite. If God would come to him and say, now it's your day, name it. What end you want your enemy to get, I'm giving it to him right now. A real kosher person would say, I don't want him to suffer. I want him to be righteous. Make him righteous, I'm happy. Let him live, let him be rich, let him be have the greatest end. I'm not wishing him any bad. I want him to be righteous, yes, for his own good. I don't wish him any bad. That's a very high level. If you know that before we leave the world, you reach that level, guarantee to be in the highest level in heaven. Guarantee. Guarantee. Moshe Rabbeinu was nominated by God to be the leader. Everyone heard. No questions about it. Everybody heard. God spoke to him and not to him. And not to Korach, and not to Datan and Aviram, and not to anyone else. To Moshe and to his brother Aaron. That's it. And yet, they make a demonstration against Moshe. And after all of that, they make fun at him. They call him a thief. They spread a rumor that he went with a married woman. All kinds of disasters that they did to him. In the end, he sent a messenger to these wicked people. Come, let's make peace. And someone else would pray, God, you made me the leader. They put me down. They embarrass you, not me. Destroy them. But Moshe, he sent someone to Datan and Aviram. Come, let's hug, let's shake hands. What did they say? Lo na'ale. No, we won't come. You won't come. I bury you under the ground alive. If they would come, that's it. It will be the end of it. You shake hands, no problem. Finish. End of story. Ego, pride, anger, all this disaster. That's where they ended. They ended buried alive with Korach and all the other 250 wicked people. So what's going on over here? So the Jewish nation, the world needed a main nation. Everyone is welcome, but you have to follow a certain test to be worthy of it. And Bilam said, I want to die like the Jews, and I want to end where they are. But what about living like a Jew? That's too much for me. I want to eat shrimps, I want to eat pork, I want to go to the beach on Shabbat, I want to drive, you know, on Shabbat. You tell me not to do this, not to do that, to be modest, not for me. Not to cheat in the business, not to steal, not to trick the customer, come on. What are you talking about? But I still want to end like the Rambam, like Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, like Rabbi Akiva, like Moshe Rabbeinu. Why not? I'll be the biggest monster on earth, and I want to finish where all the most righteous people in the history. Even no chutzpah. No chutzpah. But Bilam wasn't the only one. Or every one of us is like this. How many times you heard a Jew getting angry when a rabbi gives a speech and he's complimenting the righteous people and he's putting down the wicked people with their horrible actions and they get angry? Who are you to judge me? Why are you saying these things? According to you, I'm not going to have a share to the world to come. Of course I'm going to have. God love me. And when the rabbi has a little guts and he says, no, he doesn't love you. You're a criminal. How can he love you? You rebel against him. You're ungrateful to him. You do everything the opposite of what he says. How should he love you? Why should he love you? What, is not normal? You go against him, you take what he gives you and you use it against him. You type in the internet against his Torah, against his rabbis. You break Shabbat. You eat things that he's saying you don't dare to eat and you want him to love you. Where are you living? It's written clearly by the Rambam in Ilchot Shuvah. Yesterday you were hated, despicable, meshukatz, metoav, the worst words in the Torah, worse. Even a worm on the floor is a higher level than a wicked Jew. That's what it's written in the Rambam. Yesterday was hated, etmol haya sanui, meshukatz, metoav, merochak, it was far from Hashem, hated, despicable. I couldn't look at him. Why? He was chiloni, secular. And today, after he did tshuva, it's in the law of repentance, chapter 3, you see over there. And today, he's loved and close and this and all these compliments. What changed? The eyes are still the same color. The hair the same color, most likely. What changed? What changed by him? Why, did he change his watch so he became a tzaddik? The actions changed. What did we read in Maftir Yonah, in Yom HaKippurim in Mincha? When Hashem sent Yonah to the city of Nineveh, 120,000 wicked goyim. He sent Yonah to Las Vegas. Yonah came into the casino. Who's in charge here? Donald. Donald, come here. Yeah, 40 days before I destroyed the place. He could have made fun of him. Who are you? I'm a rabbi. Who are you to tell me what to do? I'm not even Jewish. You come here to our country, you're giving a speech, in 40 days we'll be destroyed. Put him in jail. We'll hang him tomorrow morning. They could have ended like that. But what happened? Not only the goyim did not disrespect him, they respected him very much. They took it to consideration. The king got off his chair. He wore a sack. He sat on the middle of the street. When all the goyim came, they all were wearing sack, putting ashes on their head and fasting. Even the animals fast. They made the animals fast also. They didn't know that the animals don't have free choice to be righteous or wicked. I'm not eating, you won't eat. When you want to eat while I'm suffering, everyone. And what happened in the end? It didn't say God saw their fasting, that they're torturing themselves, that they wore a sack, that the king sat on the floor. No. It's all impressive. It's written, Vayar Hashem, ki shavu mima'aseim araim. Hashem saw that they came back from their evil actions, meaning they changed their bad habits. They returned the stolen money, they stopped with their idols, they stopped with their all kinds of sex crimes that they used to do. They became all of a sudden moral and ethic. They realized, they know what they do is wrong. But they got scared. Fear is the most productive way to change a person and fast. Don't ever believe anyone who tells you that's not the right way. That's the best way. And that's the fastest way. If it's a very high soul that can connect to Hashem out of love 100%, no. Lucky guy. Lucky girl. Beautiful. I wish we all be like that. Most of the people in the world are not like that. Without fear, they do not make progress. And next time when you have a person that comes and tell you, I became religious out of love, I put my life on the line that it's a lie. How is that? You bring him to me 5 minutes, I'll prove to you that most of the things that he does, he's afraid to die, he's afraid not to get married, he's afraid not to find shidduch, he's afraid with what's going to be with his children, he's afraid. People are afraid. They know when you go against God, in the back of our mind, we know one day the price would come. Maybe not now. We're counting that we will have enough time to do tshuva before the retaliation. But in the back of our mind, for those who learn Torah and knows the rules, we know it's just a matter of time until we're going to pay for what we do. Well, you speak Lashon Hara, destroy a person in the internet, and you expect to get away with that. What happened to you? You're not normal. You didn't read the Torah, how many examples the Torah... Miriam, the sister of Moshe Rabbeinu, she loved him very much. Was her young brother. She stood a week to protect him, to make sure somebody would come and pick him up. She put him, she hid him in the Nile. She risked her life even. So she loved him very much. What sister doesn't like her young baby brother? She loved him very much. She was a prophet, he was a prophet. Their father is the most righteous person in the history, one of the top four in the history, Amram. They're very decent people. So definitely she wasn't bad, she wasn't wicked, and she had nothing against Moshe. That's for sure. When she found out that he left his wife Tzipora and he doesn't touch her, she didn't know all the details. So she started to speak to Aaron. Why is he doing it? With good intention. Not that she wants to put him down and destroy his life. And Hashem made her leprosy. You know what an embarrassment was that? Do you know what it means? You're a holy woman, you're a prophet, you're the daughter of the chief rabbi of the nation of Israel. Now you come out on the house and everybody see your entire skin all with rash. And what do they know? That you spoke Lashon Hara. They don't know about who. But they know that you just did a horrible crime. And God made you leprosy. And now you have to be isolated in a week away from the nation of Israel. Everybody stood and waited for her for 1 week. Why? She waited for Moshe to make sure that he's going to be safe. Everybody waited for her. Midah keneged midah. So when she meant well, and she was right about her claim, and she still spoke against Moshe, imagine what will be the end of the people who mean bad and they want to hurt and they want to put people down and they mean only negative. What will be their end? Think about it. Multiply it by millions of times that we did it in our life and understand where we're going to end. That's logic. Common, simple logic. Unless if we will fix our ways. Why did we have Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, Elul, all these things? What? For what? To sing in a choir, in a synagogue, Chatanu Lefanecha, with the drums, you know? to shake the hearts. So, Bet HaMikdash, the design, the location of Bet HaMikdash is already in a blueprint. The name of Mashiach, who is eventually will be the Mashiach. And tshuva, repentance. Repentance was designed before the world was created. Why? Why couldn't be designed after? I don't get it. We have people, yes. There is free choice, yes. There is Torah, yes. There is reward and punishment, yes. Give an option of repentance. Why did it have to be before all of that? It should have come in the end. No? The answer, because it's against the law of nature. If the law of nature is that every action has consequences, you burn a tree, the entire neighborhood is on fire, people dying, people becoming orphans, widows. Why? Because you burn a tree. There are consequences. What the tree has to do with this woman? The answer, one thing leads to another, right? You put too much oxygen in the area, someone lights a cigarette, the whole neighborhood goes on fire. Actions have consequences. So if the Torah taught us that certain things that we do would reflect good or bad in our life, that's reality. That's the law of nature, physical and spiritual. How repentance comes in? It's against the rules. It doesn't make any sense. What? You accumulate $20 million debt to the electric company and now you say, "Chatati aviti pashat." I'm sorry. So no problem. 20 years just went down the drain. Nothing happened. How can it be? Where else do you see such thing? If a person went into a car accident and became paralyzed, he's going to scream, "Chatati aviti pashati." He's going to come out of his wheelchair? No. He's going to be there forever. There are consequences. There are things that cannot be reversed. You put your hand in a fire, you don't have a hand. You lost it. It won't help you if you be a righteous rabbi one day. The hand is gone. Maybe they put you a bionic one, you know? Special one with the robot. Now, Baruch Hashem, they have ones even that with the mind, it moves the hands, you know? The legs. Baruch Hashem, the science is progressing. They make all kinds of inventions, Baruch Hashem. But bottom line, actions have consequences for good or for bad? For good and for bad. For instance, you went to yeshiva for 1 year and you learned very serious. You became a better person, better manners. You're knowledgeable in Torah. Now there is a beautiful, righteous, modest, polite, classy girl. They ask her, there is a guy named Moshe. Is 21 years old and you are 19, we want to set you up with him. She begins to ask questions. Who is he? Where is he from? Where is he learning? She checks and she finds out that he's a very good learner. He's a tzaddik. He loves Hashem. He loves to learn. He's, you know, mamash, a very nice person. So she agreed to date him and they get married and they have great family and everything by their entire life and their children and grandchildren will be paradise. What caused that? The 1 year that this Moishe sat and learned in the books day and night, reflected in his life and children and grandchildren until the end of time, and will continue to reflect in the next world, when this world will be over. Actions have consequences and continuation. If Moishe would be in a casino in Las Vegas for 1 year, she would agree to date him? No, so they wouldn't get married. Who would he marry? Christine. Who would be his children? Johnny, Vinny, Tony. And where would they be? In Bay Ridge, in the Italian mafia. Like, what's his name? Bugsy Siegel, that invented Las Vegas, the city of the gambling and the prostitution. Was also a Jew. And what do you think? His father wasn't Shomer Shabbat? And where is he ended? And where the other one ended? One choice can change everything. One choice. You chose a girl because of her beauty only. Nothing else was there, just beauty. You're going to pay the price, what do you think? The beauty excites you right now for 6 months. After that, you get used to it. You don't sit for 20 years. Unbelievable. In the first few days, you're very excited. Just like you buy a $100 million Picasso picture. First few days, Moshe, all days, wow, how did he do it? Look at this line. Look at this kishkush. Picasso, wow. After a year, why, Moshe, why you don't look at the picture? Last time I visited, you didn't move from the wall. It's nothing. I'm looking for a buyer. What change? You get used to beauty. Especially the picture will stay pretty. The people not always stay pretty after 34 years. If you know what I mean. Especially after the holidays. So you understand the point. The point is, it's important. Don't get me wrong. It's important. It's a part of marriage. It's a part of relationship. But it's not the main thing. And if you make it the main thing, you'll pay the price. What is the first sin that were made in a creation? Hashem created Adam. And in the day that he was created, he also gave him a wife. Vayar Hashem, ki lo tov eyot Adam levado. It's not good that the man will be alone. I will make him an assistant. Ezer, help. Ezra, it's help. Ezer, kenegdo. What does it mean, kenegdo? Kenegdo means something that is a cross. You sit here, someone in front of you. Straight. Face to face. That's called kenegdo. What's the secret behind this word, kenegdo? The Torah could have said mulo. It's also a cross. The Torah could also say ito, with him. The Torah can use different words. Why the Hashem used the word kenegdo? The oral Torah explains, zacha, if he has the merit, ezer. Lo zacha, kenegdo. If he is righteous and he has the merit, his wife will do everything for him. Not only cooking and cleaning and raising the children and doing errands for him and giving him love and attention and supports him mentally and, you know, all the great things that the good wives do. Lo zacha, doesn't have the merit. Kenegdo. He loves the IRS more than he loves his wife. Well, how can it be? They're not giving me so much hard time like her. One wife, her husband told her, honey, you don't mind that this year I'm going to go to Uman, right? So she looks at him. She was in the middle of Tehillim. She couldn't talk. He said to her, don't worry, I'm going to pray over there a lot, very strong. When she finished the Tehillim, you know how when a woman gets angry, he already knew he has a problem. So he said to her, what do you want me to pray for? He said, pray that you can find a shidduch. 2 years, you're not coming back. You want to leave us on holiday alone? Stay over there. So, Ezer, she can be the best friends that you have. Take care of all your needs. Like some men will tell you, without my wife, I'm not worth anything. I cannot do anything. I cannot live one day. Don't know anything. I tell you, I had a friend. Many years I didn't see him. He's a very big tzaddik, talmid chacham. His wife was a very big righteous woman. She passed away from cancer. She was the head of Bet Yaakov school in Monzi. And he was one of these genius rabbis that live in their own planet, if you know what I mean. Not the regular, usual ones who come, who teach, who socialize. No. He was much in a different planet, feeling on his head all day, isolated with the books. Very, very spiritual person. When she passed away, the funeral that she had was the most heart-ripping that I've ever participated. There was thousands of people and all the girls from the school, everyone was crying. And then he gave a eulogy about his wife. Most of it was in Yiddish, I don't understand, but I see everyone is crying. A day or two after the funeral, he called me up. We became friendly. who used to come to pray with us, the Sfaradim, in the Netz Minyan, very early in the morning. So he called me up. He said, I need your help. Can I come to you? I have to talk to you about something. I said, yeah, of course, come. He came to my house. He told me, I need a loan for $2,000. I said, of course. But what happened? He said, my wife passed. For the last 30 years, she was taking care of everything. I don't know what accounts I have, how much money we have. I don't know anything. I don't know how to write a check. I don't know anything. For 30 years, I did not step once into a store. Never. 5 years, I was in the attic of the house. I didn't come down besides bathroom. I was isolated from the world. A little bit on Shabbat, this, that's it. Didn't go anywhere, nothing. I didn't see people. All I did is learn Torah nonstop. I used to ask her from upstairs, you okay? You manage with the kids, with the mortgage, with everything? Say, yeah, don't worry. Only later I found out she was months behind, she was struggling. She never told me. Even when before she passed, an hour or two, sitting next to her bed, she told him, why are you sitting here wasting time? Go learn. I said, Narka, I have to be with you. You're sick? She said, no, you batlan. You're looking for excuse not to learn. 2 hours before her death. Other woman, Moshe, don't leave me. Where are you going? What kind of husband you are? Even now you leave me? His wife, why are you sitting next to me, you doctor? Go, learn Torah. Was a very, very special woman. He did not come for 5 years out. He never went into a store. Do you understand what a wife he had? I say in my mind, who knows how many thousands of people should have died, and instead of them, Hashem took this righteous woman. It's written in the Torah that sometimes instead of taking thousands, Hashem pick up one tzaddik, or tzaddeket. One, which equal on a scale, spiritually, like 1,000 Jews or 10,000 Jews. Depend on their actions. Not every Jew is equal. Not everyone is equal. You can have even two very big rabbis. They know a lot of Torah. One can be equal a million times more than the other. How can it be? They know, they have both finished the Shas. They both finished Shulchan Aruch. They both know to answer almost every question. They both keep the mitzvot. They're both more or less the same age. So what is it? Why one is equal a million times like the other? One, everything he learned, he does for himself. That's it. The other one shared his knowledge with thousands. He made a lot of people religious. He has a lot of students. Many of the secular people became Shomrei Shabbat. They started to learn Torah. After many years, it became a tribe of many, many secular people who became religious. So every day that passed by, the first rabbi that only learned for himself, and that's it, and he has his family and children, he gained X amount. The other one get a million or a billion times more, depending how many Baalei Tshuva he made. So he grows from 10 to 100, from 100 to 1,000, and he grow from a million to 10 million to 100 million to 100 billion to trillions. To the way they grow is not the same, because he has him, and he makes all the mitzvot for himself, and that's it. And the other one has 20, 30, 50, or 100,000 people works for him. So they make a lot more for him. So he is on a scale much more important in his chuyot than the other one. You understand? Therefore, obviously, not everyone is equal to the other. So sometimes, instead of a horrible pogrom, it's written in Shir HaShirim, Dodi Arad Legano. Hashem, Dodi is Hashem, in Shir HaShirim. He went down to the garden, Yarad Legano, Lilkot Shoshanim, to pick the roses, Keshoshana Ben Achochim. Every rose have thorns around it. Why? To protect it from the animals. You know, when you put flowers, the animals come to eat it. If you have a garden, you know what I'm talking about. The deer, all these animals, raccoons, whatever. They come, they eat. You have beautiful flowers. That's why they put, or the birds, They eat them. You come in the morning, you see the deer. They eat all the trees. It's very interesting. The tree becomes like mushrooms. Because up to a certain height, they can reach. More than that, they cannot reach. So the bottom is very, very thin. And the top, that's very nice. They have to eat, no? So the idea is that these thorns protecting the flowers. Well, otherwise, why would Hashem make thorns in it? A person wants to bring to his wife a rose, she grabs it, yes, it worked. What is the, there's no other excuse for that. The answer is to protect it. Keshoshana ben achochim. So sometimes you go in the field, you have massive amount of weeds and thorns, all of a sudden, one beautiful flower. Right away, it's a different view here. It's surrounded with garbage, one diamond. You understand? Also in the world, if you go in Arizona over there, they find gold. Tons of water and, rocks and sand. And they go like this with the nets. Oh, here is a piece of gold. Tiny piece of gold. So much garbage, one tiny piece of gold. That's how it is. So, time is running out. What else was created before the world, meaning the plan was set for it? Heaven and hell. In the beginning, what does it mean, Bereshit? The Ramban writes, creation of time. Because when you use the word beginning, middle, and those terms are all relates to time. So as soon as the Torah start in the beginning, meaning there had to be time, but there was no world yet. So the Ramban explained, in the beginning means the second, the first second that material was created, that time began. That's creation of time. That's what it means, Bereshit. Bara Elokim et ha-shamayim ve-et ha-aretz. והארץ הייתה תוהו ובוהו וחושך על פני תהום. And the land was תוהו ובוהו, total mess, total mess and darkness. It was deep, all covered with water. Imagine what's scary, all black, you don't see anything, everything covered with water. ורוח אלוקים מרחפת על פני המים. The spirit of God, the שכינה of Hashem, is above the water. ויאמר אלוקים, יהי אור, ויהי אור. Hashem said there should be light, and there was light. Which light? Not the light of the sun. The sun will be hanged only on Wednesday, the fourth day. It's now we're talking the first day of creation. So there's no sun, no moon, no stars yet, no nothing. What kind of sun? What kind of light? Spiritual light. 100% spiritual. It penetrates between materialistic object. The light that Hashem created, you don't have it today in the world. It was taken away by the fourth day and was replaced with the sun. This light, you could have seen like they have MRI or rentgen. You can see from an object, like in a suitcase in the airport, they see on the screen what you have in the suitcase. How does it penetrate the camera into the holes of your suitcase and check everything over there and they see the images? It's a special technology, it's called rentgen, special waves. Rentgen was the person who discovered them, that's why they named after him. But in the Torah, way before Mr. Rentgen, we already had things that penetrate and see through objects. So what happened? This light was taken away and reserved for the righteous people for the future to come. That's what the Oral Torah and the Kabbalah teach. It's called Or Aganuz, the hidden light. And Hashem puts away. Why? This light was healing, was an unbelievable spiritual feeling. Unbelievable. And it was replaced with the sun. The sun, the light of the sun, I once made a whole lecture about it. It's called the light. I ask a question, if the light of the sun is spiritual or physical? The light of the sun, what is it? It's something gashmi, materialistic, it's material, or it's spiritual, or both? Rough enough, what do you think? Huh? Why I'm asking this question? Quickly, I don't have the intention to repeat the whole 2 hours lecture that I gave about it. But just briefly, for us to understand why it's a problematic question, the answer, the scientists do not know to answer this question. They don't know. Why? Because we have the rules of nature. And according to the rules of nature, something that has a speed, then means it's material. Material moved in a certain speed. It depends on the weight, it depends on gravity, it depends on many things, that it's all the material world. The light of the sun has a speed. It travels 300,000 kilometers per second. 300,000 kilometers per second. Like 200,000 miles a second. You understand? 200,000 miles. From here to the end of Long Island is not, it's 100 miles. 200,000 miles. Think about what distance in 1 second. So therefore, the light has a speed. If something has a speed, it's material. Here you go. Here is the answer. Not so simple. Why?
No matter. Light has no matter. There's no matter in light.
Meaning? Wait, I'll explain. This is my next thing. So the next thing is, if you have a ball, right, a tennis ball, and you throw it, and it goes in a speed 80 miles an hour, like the baseball that they throw, 80 miles an hour. What happened when he hit the hand of the other person, or the glove? He stopped the ball. So the speed went from 80 miles per hour to 0 miles per hour in a second. The second that he grabbed the ball, the speed went immediately to zero. What happened if it flew out of his hand? It was so strong he couldn't hold it, and he continued. He reduced from 80 miles an hour to 1 mile an hour until it stopped completely. That's it. Now it doesn't move. That's it. It's on the floor. Zero. Zero traveling. Zero. Zero speed. The light of the sun. If you have a glass, it penetrates from the glass with no resistance. You see it inside the room, no resistance. If you close the shed, half of the light is gone. It becomes shadow. You don't see 100% light like before. Meaning the blinds, they are holding some of the light. The darker the blinds are, the more light it prevents. If you make it very, very strong black, almost no light goes in. Very interesting. It's mamash. Or the wall, same thing. The wall, the darker it is, the more it stops the light. So we find that dark object is a big obstacle to the traveling of the light. The darker it is, the more it stops the speed of light. This is how it goes. But once the light penetrates, some of it, what happens once it goes beyond the obstacle, meaning it passed the blinds or the wall, it accelerates back to 300,000 kilometers per second without energy. That's a very big mystery. Nobody knows how.
But scientists say that the wall can be a black wall. It doesn't stop the light. The light just bounces back at the same speed.
All right. But some of the light goes to the other side of the wall. Right?
Yes, unless it's
or to the blinds. Unless if it's completely thick and black, completely, then it could be that nothing goes beyond it. Right? But some of the lights penetrate. And the lights that penetrate should have fallen on the floor, like the ball, right? Because something stopped it. It doesn't travel 300,000 kilometers per second. Once it penetrates to the other side, the speed should have reduced constantly until it would stop completely. It won't continue to travel another million miles away. But the light, after it was stopped, it always accelerates back to 300,000 kilometers per second by itself, without any power that push it. The ball, it's my arm. I create the energy with my muscles, with my strength. I throw the ball, it's depend on the weight on the ball. That's what creates the speed of the ball. But here, if you have an airplane, what makes the airplane move? The burning of the gasoline, right? They put gas, it burns, it creates pressure, and it pushes the airplanes away, like a balloon. If you blow out air into a balloon and you stop, what happened to the balloon? It flies like an airplane, right? Because all the air goes in one shot, it pushed the balloon away. That's how the airplanes work, same idea. But eventually the energy finished. The air that I put in a balloon would last for a second or two. That's it. After that, the balloon will fall on the floor. The ball, after a second or two, will fall on the floor. Everything that you give a push, once the energy finish, the speed is going down to zero. But here, the light of the sun, out of nowhere, nobody understands how can it be. It's against the law of nature. Always accelerate by itself. And exactly to the same speed it was before. How can it be? It's against the law of material. It's against the law of nature. That's why the scientists are puzzled. They don't know how to call it. On one hand, it's physical. You see, it travel. On the other hand, it's not 100% physical. It has spiritual elements in it. We know the answer. It's half and half. The original light was 100% spiritual. No speed of traveling. Constant light all the time. Comes and goes with Hashem's choice. After that, Hashem put the sun and the moon and the whole system, and it tells us Rosh Chodesh and when Shabbat is and where is a day and where is a night. Why Hashem needed to do it? Because Judaism depends on the stars. On the sun and the moon and the stars. How do you know when you can do Brit Milah? Only when it becomes day, after sunrise, not before. How do you know when you have to stop doing things? When Shabbat, when the sunset comes, here you go. Shabbat begins. So it depends on the stars, on the movement of the stars, on the cycle of the moon and the sun, summer, winter, the place where Earth is in comparison to the sun. All these movements and galaxies and all these, you know, orbits and all these things that we have around us, this is a part of Judaism. That's why a Jew cannot live in Scandinavia. He cannot live in those places that is 6 months day. That's it. No day and night. When do you do Shema Israel? When do you do Brit Milah? Now 6 months darkness. You have a baby. You cannot do Brit Milah at night. What are you going to do now? You wait for the baby until he becomes bar mitzvah? You got to do it on the 8th day. The poskim writes, Jew cannot live in these places. Hashem doesn't want you to live there. You have to live in Eretz Israel. For whatever reason, you cannot live in Eretz Israel. You live in a place when they have day and night according to the rules of the Torah. Even in Europe, it's very difficult to be a Jew. Very difficult. Why? In some places, I was in Belgium or in Holland, in some of the places, 11 o'clock at night become dark. 11 o'clock. Now think about it for a second. Now we had 8 days of Sukkot. 7 days Sukkot, 8 days Shmini Atzeret. And the Arvit of Shmini Atzeret, which was Sunday night, it replaced, the prayer replaced from Sukkot to Shmini Atzeret. We don't say anymore Sukkot. What happened in Belgium if now it was if it's become dark at 11 o'clock? They have to sit and wait until 11, until they can say Shmini Atzeret. It's not like Shabbat. Shabbat you can accept earlier. But now you don't know what to say. Sukkot or Shmini Atzeret? You cannot say Shmini Atzeret because it's still Sukkot. It's light outside. You must have night. Now, if you wait until it becomes night, by the time you start your meal, it will be after midnight. Great life for the children. It's very difficult. So in some places, it's very difficult, mamash, to keep the laws, day and night. Here in America, it's easy. Similar to Israel. But in other countries, in some places, mamash, it's almost impossible. So, there is also a hint over here. What does it mean? When your life is a mess, everything around you is a mess. Nothing works, no job, no marriage, no this problem with the children, all kinds of problems that people have. And you think, my life is a disaster. Vechoshech, you have darkness in your life, spiritual, everything dark. Don't forget that Ruach Elokim merachefet me'al pnei ha'mayim. Vayomer Elokim vayayor. It's just a matter of time until Hashem will send the light. Don't give up. It's a secret here. Vayomer Elokim yayor. In the beginning of the Torah, you don't find the name Hashem, Yud Kei Vav Kei. Only Elokim, Elokim, Elokim. Elokim is judgment. The world was created in judgment. Only judgment, no mercy. When Hashem saw that the people are, how to say it in a nice way, losers, then he mixed the mercy, Yud Kei Vav Kei. I gave you a mission, all of you failing. Cain, murder, Hevel, right away. Adam HaRishon, right away, make a scene. What's the first scene in the world? I know what you're about to say. That Adam HaRishon ate from the tree that Hashem say not to eat. True. But what is the real sin? Eating from a tree, it's a sin? What's the problem eating from a tree? Did you ever see a tree in the world that you cannot eat from it? Besides Ola, the tree itself is kosher. The time is not kosher. It's a different story. Also in Yom Kippur, you cannot eat an orange from the tree. It doesn't make the orange not kosher. The time is not allowing. But the trees, all of them are kosher. Everything natural is kosher. That grows vegetables, fruits. All of a sudden, one tree is not kosher. Do you know how many trees, when Hashem put Adam in Garden of Eden, and he told him, your job is to be in charge of the garden, and there's tons of great fruits, and the angels serving him, a much great life he had. Do you know how many different trees they had in the garden? How many trees they had? Some people think, maybe it was a little garden, like in the neighborhood, you know? 10 by 10, 50 by 50, you walk from one side to the other. There were tens of thousands of trees and 15,000 different flavors. When will he ever finish to enjoy the flavors? And he was walking naked and his wife walking naked and they didn't know that anything is wrong. They didn't have bina. Wisdom did not penetrate their head yet. So obviously this tree was some kind of a spiritual tree. The Gemara say maybe it was grape, maybe it was fig, maybe it was chita, different opinions. Bottom line, the main opinion that it was the grape tree, grapes. Grape is this most spiritual fruit. You make wine from it. All this Jewish ceremonies is with wine. Nothing with orange juice, nothing with any vegetable. Everything with wine. Wine, marriage, wine. Brit Milah, wine. Kiddush, wine. Avdalah, wine. Everything wine. Pesach, wine. Why wine? Everything wine. Because Adam HaRishon ate from the tree which Hashem told him not to eat and ruined the world. And the Torah and the mitzvot fixed the world. Fix the sin of Adam. You ruin the world with grapes, you fix the world with the same thing. Midah keneged midah. That's the main secret here. Why it has to be all with grapes. But the real sin was not eating from a tree. What do you mean? Hashem said, don't touch the tree. And he touched the tree and he ate. Yes, but for that Hashem wouldn't give him the horrible punishment that he gave him. Because Hashem has a lot of patience when the sin is something that has to do with physical desire. If a person ate something, was very hungry, and it wasn't so kosher, it's a sin. He broke the laws of the Torah. But it's not so hard to fix the sin. You do tshuva and Hashem forgive. You don't have death penalty for eating not kosher. You don't have horrible hell for that. You're not allowed to do it. It contaminates the blood, it contaminates the soul, yes. But we don't find that penalty for eating not kosher. What is the main crime? The ungratefulness aspect. Hashem came to him and said to him, did you eat from the tree? I told you not to. He didn't say, yes, I'm so sorry, I don't know what happened to me. I was curious, I had desire. No. If that's what Adam would say, he would not get the punishment he got. Not even 1% of it. He right away said to him, what do you want from me? It's her fault. This woman that you made for me, she was supposed to help me. Look what she did already. First thing she did, it put me in a hole. You know, they have a question. Why Adam lived 930 years, such long life? The only person who lived longer life than him is Metushelach, 969 years. Adam, 930. And he gave 70 years to David HaMelech, supposed to live 1,000 years. Because Hashem told him, the day you eat from the tree, you'll die, and the day for Hashem, it's 1,000 years. Ke'elef shanim be'enecha ke'yom, it says in Tehillim. 1,000 years for you is a day. And Hashem made the world in 6 days, which is 6,000 years. That's why the world will be 6,000 years. 6 days, one each day is 1,000 years. So, why Adam lived such long life? Very simple, he didn't have a mother-in-law. No one to tell you what to do to make him miserable, to bring the wife home. Come home! We'll teach him a lesson. Ay, ay, ay. Why Hashem didn't make Adam and Eve Chinese? They'll eat the snake and ruin the show. In China, they eat snakes. So, the answer is the ungratefulness for that. I gave you such beautiful wife, you enjoy it there, your life will be great. It's because I know it's not good for you to be alone. You're not complete when you're alone. So and by the way, you should know that the most beautiful woman in history was Chava. How do you know? Because Hashem designed her personally. Not with the help of the laws of nature and DNA and genes. It's directly. There could be a software that was designed by some kind of an artist. But it's not 100% his hand. That's why it's not worth that much. When he himself drew the picture, right away, $100 million. But a computer who uses techniques, $30. Hashem actually designed it. It couldn't be more perfect than that. And what did he say? It's her fault. And what did she say? It's his fault. Everyone throw the guilt to someone else, like in the army. Like in the FBI or the CIA. They're looking for someone to sacrifice. Shaul HaMelech, when Shmuel came to him, he blamed the nation. The nation wanted to sacrifice. That's why I didn't kill the sheep. But when he came to David, right away David said, Chatati Lashem. Immediately. That's the difference between Shaul and David. Shaul was more righteous than David, the Gemara said. And David made two mistakes. One with Bathsheba, the story with Bathsheba. And Uriah sending him, and he died. It didn't look so good. And Shaul, he didn't want to do anything against Hashem. He figured, why to kill a million sheep now? Let's use them, sacrifice them, do some mitzvot with that. It wasn't something that he wanted to, Hashem, I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going to do what you told me better for you. In his mind, he made a mistake. Also Shlomo. Shlomo married 1,000 wives. Not regular wives. All of them were princesses, all of them. Daughters of kings from all the tribes, from the countries. Why? They all wanted him, and he took advantage on that. Why? Did he really need 1,000 women? What normal man can live with 1,000 wives? He doesn't remember their names. What's your name? Remind me. I'm sorry. I'm getting confused. The answer is, he was teaching them and sending them back to their countries. Like this, he spread the belief in one God all over the world. But the Torah said that you cannot have more than maximum 18 wives all together with the Pilakshim. Pilakshim is a wife, but without ketubah, without marriage. He makes her, this woman, as his kosher mistress. The people don't do it anymore, but back in the time, the king has wives and they had other wives without ketubah. They can have children with them, but they have to be only him and her, nobody else. No cheating, nothing like that. Mamash like a wife. So, Hashem said maximum 18 altogether. But Shlomo had a plan. I want to make the whole world religious. What happened in the end of his life? A horrible thing is written about Shlomo HaMelech in Melachim Aleph. Horrible. Mamash shame to even read it. What does it say? That Shlomo HaMelech went off the derech. Shlomo HaMelech went off the derech. He went in spirituality down, and the women turned his heart away from Hashem. That's what it's written. Mamash busha. Shlomo HaMelech, Mashiach comes from him. The greatest son of David HaMelech built Beit HaMikdash. The smartest person ever lived. Age 12, he became the king before his bar mitzvah. The women took his heart away from Hashem. If you connected to the women day and night strongly, you're done with Hashem. That's the way it is. That's it. Your mind is not into Kedusha anymore. They turned his heart away from Hashem. And we're not talking about one little Jew here from around the corner here that had a girlfriend and she drove him crazy and he went off the derech. We're talking Shlomo HaMelech, greater than a prophet. What happened in the end? Vayasara b'enei Hashem. Imagine Shlomo HaMelech, how much he suffered from those two verses in the end of his life. As a bushot, something like this is written about you in the Tanakh. By the way, that's a proof that the Tanakh is 100% objective and real. In Islam, did you ever hear something bad about Muhammad? Never. Was better than God according to them. Never make mistakes. JC, better than perfect. In the Torah, all the leaders, the good about them is written and the bad as well. Avraham Avinu, it's written also the bad. Yitzchak, the bad. Yaakov, the bad. The punishments that they got. Everything it's written. David HaMelech, what he did right, what he did wrong. When Hashem was happy with him, when he got angry at him. Why did I have to write about Shlomo HaMelech that he had, in the end, the women turn away his heart? No one would know it. Put it under the rug. In Hollywood, you like the happy end, no? Why you ruined the movie in the last 2 minutes? Make a happy end, that everyone will go home with a smile. What a great movie. If the hero died in the last minute, no one likes the movie anymore. You shoot yourself in the leg. Make the end of Shlomo HaMelech. Only you know that he did bad. No, everyone has to know in the history. It's not. It's an embarrassment. It's Chilul Hashem. Ma. You have to write it in the Tanakh. Hashem is sealed, is emet. He doesn't move from the truth. For good and for... That's what happened. That's it. It has to be written. Plus, it's education for us. If great people like this fail, let's not think that we're anything better. We have to know our limitation. Shlomo HaMelech said, I'm going to have a lot of women and I will not make sins. And what happened in the end? He fell in what the Torah warned. And he had good intention. And Adam over here, Adam, when Hashem said to him, did you eat from the tree? Two things he said. One, it's written in the Torah. One is not. What's written in the Torah is that he blamed his wife. And Hashem said, look at this ungratefulness. I gave him a gift, and now he's throwing it back in my face and telling me it's your fault. Because of her, I did it. Right? And one more thing he said. You know what he said? Achalti ve'ochal od. I ate and I will eat again. I'll eat again. The interesting thing is, if Hashem would come to one of us, to me, to him, to her, and would tell us, why did you do this? What would happen to us? What will be our reaction? Whether you're Jew, whether you're Goy, whether you're righteous, whether you're wicked. If Hashem comes to a human being, even he came to Lavan. Lavan was wicked. He got very scared. He came to hurt Yaakov right away. Changed his approach. Bilam came to curse the Jews. Hashem came and warned him right away. Became a Baba. Coming with blessing. If Hashem would come to us, whether we're good or bad, if Hashem would warn us or complain to us about something we did, would we ever dare to answer to him, I did it and I'll do it again whether you like it or not? What human being would do such thing? Muhammad, he won't do it. Chris, he won't do it. Bruce Lee, he won't do it. Itzik, he won't do it. So how Adam did such a thing? How can it be? How can it be? How can it be? The answer, the only answer I can come up with, that he didn't understand the concept of reward and punishment yet. Ungratefulness, yes. That's what Hashem blaming for. For ungratefulness. And for that, all the suffering, by the way. How much we suffer to make a living. How much women suffer giving birth, raising children. All this suffering from 1 minute of desire. But it's not the desire, because for the desire, Hashem will forgive. It's for the chutzpah, that Chava did not take responsibility, and Adam did not take responsibility. And this is what the Torah says, Ineni nishpat otach al omrech lo chatati. You should know, most of the punishment is for saying, I'm good. Ani tzadik, like in Israel. Bye-bye. Ani tzadik. All these people who go like this, Ani tzadik, even if they don't go with the hand. Ani tzadik! 1,000,000% Rasha. Do you know one real righteous person that will announce in public, I am righteous? Even when people want to present themselves as righteous, they make sure that the shamash will do the job. Go, tell them who I am. I'm important. Who is my father? My family, how much Torah I know. Make someone do the PR. He doesn't come and stand in front of the whole world making himself look like a clown. Only Donald is doing it. But someone with Torah, he would be embarrassed to talk about himself. The opposite. If he know, if they ask him, they say they came to Rav Ovadia Yosef. They say, Rabbi, I heard that you know the whole Torah by heart. Don't exaggerate. Only half. So, oh yeah? Half? It's also good. Which half? Say whichever one you want. That's only in the jokes. In reality, if people come and say to him, Rabbi, you know the whole Torah by heart, what would he say? Let's see, he knows. Why are you listening to people? Of course not. I have many years to go. The Gemara say, you know two masachtot, you can say I know one. Not like today. He doesn't know two lines. He already pretends he's Rambam. The Rav HaGaon, HaTzadik, HaGadol, HaOr HaGagal. How many? Some people write every Shabbat, every Friday, they write Alon. What's the only reason they write the Alon? You know, the Alon, the pamphlets of the Parashat HaShavua? Why they write it? Those, what do you call it? Flyers, whatever you want to call it. Why they write it? Only for one reason, that the headlines, everyone that would read it would see Harav, Agaon, ta ta ta, with all the titles that he writes for himself. Bereshit, Mosdot, Harav, Agaon. He cannot sleep at night if people would not kiss his hand. One rabbi, once he said in his lecture, I appreciate his honesty. He said, before I worked on my ego, that was like my mental disease, ego, pride. I used to teach in yeshiva for a lousy salary, $200 a week. And then when one of my students used to get married, I used to take a taxi special, taxi private, all the way to the catering place for the 2 minutes fame that they announced my name in a microphone, the great rabbi, the rabbi of the chatan, the rabbi of the groom, rabbi such and such, a gaon, the genius, mechubad lebracha charita, that they're giving him bracha in a chupa. And I will walk from my chair all the way to the stage, to the chupa, and everyone rise. Wow, 2 minutes of fame. $200 I would pay for the taxi special from Bnei Brak to Yerushalayim and to come back 1 week. I walk for the 2 minutes kavod. If this is not mental disease, what else? It's a mental disease. How much Donald Trump lost because of his ego? Imagine if he would be humbled. He would be the president without the chlal competition. The only reason that he's going to lose is only because his personality. Because I promise you that the most of the Americans are not that dumb to want another 100,000 terrorists here and all kinds of disaster that will be in this country. But they think, how can I vote to a person like this? Who knows what's going to be next with his mouth? What is he going to get us into? People are worried. I know, I spoke to some people. Told me, listen, in the beginning, there was mamash no issue for me. I wanted to vote, but after I see how he talks, and I rather suffer with this whatever, you know, than not to know what comes next. You understand? We will finish here, mamash, in another minute. It says like this. Vayar Hashem ki tov, vayavdel Elokim ben haor uven hachoshech. Hashem separated between the night, the day and the night. Vayikra la'or yom ulachoshech kara laila. That was the first day. Then Hashem separated the water. Water above the heaven and water below the heaven. That's how we have Shamayim. What Shamayim in Hebrew means? Sham. Sham means there. Maim, water. Maim, it's water. Sham, Maim. Where is the water? In space. In the galaxies, in the stars, they're full of ice. Because the temperature is so low over there, it all became ice, but it's water. Ice is water. And there's water on the earth. And in the beginning, it was all one continent, not seven. Only it became seven 1,500 years later, in a flood. When the floody days of rain came and water came from the spring, boiling water from the ground, that broke the continent into seven. They started to shift all over and all kinds of crumbs fell and you have islands everywhere. The way the world is designed today is from 4,200 years ago. Before that, there was a different map. There is a scientist named Wagner, non-Jew. Wagner can be Jewish, can be not Jewish. Wagner, he lived from 1870 to 1920, 50 years only, short life. His major discovery, that was Ramash, a huge discovery in science, that the world was one continent that broke into seven, and he shows which continent broke from what place. This part was connected here, like a puzzle. And he shows the green with the green, the brown with the brown, the desert with the desert, show mamash measurement, and he got an award for it. We don't need Wagner. We have the Zohar. The Zohar says, Yabeshet achat haita v'nishbera l'sheva. There was one continent who broke to seven. How great is to be a Jew? You press a button, like Google. Right away, the Torah pulled the answer. Before Google. You have everything in the Torah, this scientist, that discovery. All their discoveries are already in the Torah. They discovered that there are more than 6,000 stars, Galileo Galilei, 1608, when he invented this telescope. It's written in the Talmud already. 19 digits number, it's written in the Talmud. There was no telescopes, no NASA, no Obama. But we still know there are trillions of stars. Great. Amazing. It's in the Gemara, in Masechet Brachot, page 32. You can read it over there. Everything is in this divine cyclopedia. Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim, Gemara. It's all there. So Hashem separated. In the second day, it doesn't say Vayar Hashem Kitov. First day, Vayar Hashem Kitov, Vayar, Vayi Boker, Yom Echad. Hashem saw that everything he made is good. He sealed the day. Vayar, Vayi Boker, and it was night, and then it was day, because in the Judaism, the night comes, it's already the beginning of the day, in sunset. One day. And then on the second day, it doesn't say Kitov. But on the third day, it says twice Kitov. Why in the second day didn't say Kitov? Because there was a separation between the water. Some water went there, some water went over there. Hashem doesn't like separations. Plus, Hashem created Gehenom on Monday, on the second day, to punish all the wicked people. A spiritual Auschwitz, or much worse, if you can imagine anything worse than Auschwitz. If you read what happened in Gehenom, you understand what I'm talking about. So what do we see? How can I say Kitov on a day like this? But in the third day, already it was creative. It was very good. Trees started to grow, grass, all kinds of things from the ground, wheat, barley. But they didn't grow really. Why Hashem waited for Adam to be created, that he should pray for the first rain. Nothing in this world is blessed unless you pray for it. Remember this. If you pray a lot for your shidduch, when you get it, you're going to have blessing. You pray, no, you didn't pray, Hashem will give you your shidduch. But you're not going to have the same blessing. You bought a house and you prayed a lot, and you did Hanukkah Tabayit, and you pray that you have blessing over there, you're going to have blessing. You didn't pray. You say thank you to Hashem. Thank you for giving me the money. I bought a house. But there's no blessing. And Chazon Ish used to pray and say thank you and pray and request things that are mandatory, that happens every minute. Wow, what are you praying for it? We have it every minute. What's praying for Hashem? But you have it. Why do you need to pray for it? You're going to have it anyway. But it's not the same. Yes, I will have it. Because Hashem is forced to give it to me, otherwise I will be dead. But when He gives it to me through my prayers, it doesn't come the same. Same thing the food. Food that you pray for parnasah, for blessing, that it comes in a kosher way, it's not the same like food that you just get because Hashem is interested to keep you alive. It's not the same. And right after that, on the fourth day, Hashem created, like I say, the stars, all the galaxies. To show us the months, the years. Okay. And then to give light and the sun, it's photosynthesis. Without the sun, nothing can grow. It's not enough to have water and rain. You need sun. Places that it's all dark, nothing grows, nothing is, you need, the plants need light. They need the warmth of the sun and they need the light of the sun. So that was the fourth day. Vayomer Elokim Yishretzu Amayim Sheretz. All the fish, all the things that lives in the water. Nefesh Chaya Ve'of Yofef Al Haaretz. The birds, the mosquitoes, the flies, the bees, all the things that flies and everything that lives in the water. The big crocodiles, some say it's the dinosaurs. I ask, where does it say in the Torah? There's big dinosaurs. They all died in a flood 4,200 years ago. They didn't enter the ark, they drowned, that's it. Kol of kanaf lemineu, vayar Hashem kitov, vayvarech otam elokim lemor pru urvu, multiply and fill up the land and the water. The fifth day. Then comes the most important day. Hashem created the animals, all the things, the snakes and the worms that crawl on the floor. Vayomer Elokim na'aseh Adam betzalmenu kedmutenu. Now it's time to create Adam in my image. Has to be a spiritual image, not physical image. Veirdu, meaning they will control bedergat hayam, the fish, and the birds, and the animals, meaning the man, the humankind, is in control of nature. It's clearly, it's written in the Torah, not like some animals activists want to give equal rights to men and animals. That's not what God wants. He wants men to control the animals, not to torture them. It's against the rules. Not to kill them for no reasons. It's against the rules, unless if there's danger or you need to eat them. But being vegetarian, it's not a part of the creation. You want to be vegetarian, it's up to you. But it's permitted to eat animals. Not like some fool made a movie that it's not allowed to eat meat. It's written in every day the Kohanim used to eat meat in Beit HaMikdash. Every day. All the sacrifices, every minute. Holidays, mitzvah to eat meat. And mitzvah and Yom Tov to eat meat. Mitzvah from the Torah, like putting tefillin. And one person make a film. Everyone today make a film. Not thinking about the consequences of their films. Trying to claim that it's not allowed to eat meat. Whatever is an incentive was. And Hashem blessed them. The world started to have tons of animals. We have more than 2 million different kinds of animals that we know today. More than 2 million kinds. And then, Vayi erev, Vayi boker, Yom HaShishi. Hashem created Adam in his image, Zachar u'Nekeva, male and female. He took from the DNA of Adam, from his rib, and he created the female. He could have created her by herself, but he wanted the women to know that the only reason they have life is to help the men. That's the way the creation is. Feminism is against the law. Man has to give rights to women, buy them gifts, give them, you know, when they get married, there's a bill of rights. Give them house, give them clothing, give them intimate relationship, buy them gifts, give them money in case they get divorced. They come before the children. Women are well protected in the Torah from all directions. However, women are less than men. And there's nothing they should be upset about. The same thing, a regular Jewish man is less than a Kohen. Shouldn't be upset in that. He's a Kohen and I'm not. Fine. That's what God says. There's a Jew and there's a non-Jew. And even among the non-Jews, there are different levels. No one should be jealous with the one that is on top of him. This is the master plan, creation, that's it. Same thing, a company make this model, cost 100,000. Next model, 80,000. Next model, 50,000. The engineer designed it according to his understanding. End of story. And he's the only one who can rate models. And can rate people. He's the only one. Every other human being who will rate people is a racist. Unless if he caught what the book of God says. That's a different story already. If he writes verses from the Torah in the name of the Creator, if the Creator doesn't have the right to decide who is higher than and the other one, who else has the right? I made the system, you tell me what to decide? So what does it say over here? That she was created from the man. Why? To show her that your life is only thanks to him. Otherwise, I would create you as a separate entity. You not depend on him. You have your own life. But today, the world, you know, everything turned around. Everything turned around. People want to do it their way. And that's why the world looks the way it looks. That's why it looks like that. Back in time, go a few hundred years ago. What was the divorce rate in the world? Close to zero. Zero. I'm telling you, Rabbi Adera told me when he was a kid, I assume he's around 70-something now, when he was a kid. So we're talking about 60 years ago, 60, 65 years ago. That's it. Two generations ago. Your grandparents. He asked his father, Abba, what is gerushin? What's divorce? He didn't know what divorce is. 10 or 15 years old. He was a kid in school. His father almost fainted. He gave him such a smack. Who told you to say this word? His father almost fainted. He went home. He asked his mother, what is so bad about this word? Don't ever say this word. Nobody dared to say the word gerushin, divorce, two generations ago. It was such a horrible word. Maybe 1 out of 1,000 couples were divorced. Not even. Today, 70, 80%, 60%, 50%, depending which city. Some cities more than 100% divorce rate. How can it be? Every family 6-7 times divorce. Brings the statistic higher than 100%. This doctor 6 times divorce. This movie star 5 times divorce. Few times. It brings the statistic higher. Why is it? A part of it is that men forgot what a man should be and women forgot what a woman should be. Everyone wants to be what he's not supposed to be. That's what happened. You understand? And obviously, you see that it's all a mess. You know, a man came home, he saw his wife, Adam. Adam came home, he saw Chava, he's very angry. Where were you? It's so late, she told him. He said, I don't understand, why are you so jealous? There's no other women, you don't have competition. She said, pick up your shirt, I want to look at your ribs. Maybe, and there was another woman created from your ribs. Jealousy is jealousy. People tell me, Rabbi, I cannot live with her, she's so jealous. Say, you fool. The day she stops being jealous, then you know your marriage is over. Jealousy, as long as you don't act crazy and start screaming and embarrass on the street like some people do, as long as you control this and you handle it in a house with respect, jealousy between a man jealous to his wife or the wife jealous to the husband, that's a sign of love. You don't want to lose what you have to someone else. That's a sign of love. If you don't care about what you have. If you have a car that worth $100 and someone stole it, I don't have to worry now where to dump it. But if it's a 200,000 brand new, nice, fancy car, you eat your heart. Wow, I just love it. Why you love it? Something that you love, you don't want to miss. You don't want to share also with someone else. You want it only for yourself. It's normal. Now comes the Torah. The Torah says some things it's mitzvah to share, but not your wife, not your husband. You understand the point? We only briefly touch a little bit the 6th day of creation. You know, this parasha, you can talk with no exaggeration, hundreds of hours, and you did not cover nothing. Chazal say, the more you dig into this chapter, the more confused you will be, because it's so complicated, the creation. So it's better to learn it from the top, like on the surface, not to penetrate too deep. Why? Because no matter, the more you understand one thing, it creates more conflict over here. And then over here, it creates, because it's very, very complicated. It's a divine creation. It's very, very difficult to understand. But, Baruch Hashem, the chapter of Bereshit, it's 1400 years. First chapter in the Torah, it describes 1400 years in the creation. 1400 years, until it comes to the time of Noah. Noah is already 4,300 years ago. The flood was 4,200 years ago. Creation about 5,700 years. So 1,500 years before, the world was created. 1,500 years later, Hashem wiped out all the wicked people. So it took Hashem 1,500 years to kill all the millions of wicked people that live on earth and start a new world. And made the world mikveh. The whole world was covered with water. Mikveh, mamash, like spiritual, to erase all the sins and the oppression that the sins make on material. Like the Ramchal writes, every sin a person does influence himself, influence the world, and influence the material around him. Make sure you're careful who you buy objects from. You buy clothes from people, you buy car from people. It's the things that they do affect the material. Today it was proven scientifically. Dr. Amado, the Japanese, he proved in a place when people speak words of positive and love, how the water look in negative 274 degrees, mamash like diamonds. Beautiful symmetric arts, unbelievable design. in rooms that people were cursed all day, it looks like the drops of ice. None of them look in any shape. An Israeli student in Bar Ilan University did a very similar experiment. In one room, he put people, all day they read Tehillim. He put cotton balls with water and seeds on the cotton balls. For 2 or 3 weeks, all day they read Tehillim. In the other room, cotton balls with seeds, bunch of people, all day cursing. They didn't go crazy, I don't know. 2 weeks cursing, all day cursing. After 2 to 3 weeks, in a room when they read Tehillim, everything grew straight, tall, beautiful, bloom, amazing. In a room that they were cursing, nothing grew. You can see his pictures from his experiment. Tomer Raviav, Google him. Tomer, T-O-M-E-R, Raviav, R-A-V-I-A-V. A student from Bar Ilan, he won an award for it. Scientific proof. The words that we speak around affect material, affect the trees, affect the growing of the wheat, the barley. Not to talk about the souls, that's needless to say. We'll see you Bezrat Hashem next Wednesday. We're moving into winter schedule, 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock, like this, by 10 we can be out of here. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen v'amen.